जो एम आई ऑडिबल? हेलो,
यस यस यू आर
या वी कैन स्टार्ट। सो द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन, दे आर आस्किंग, गिवन द रूट नोड ऑफ अ बाइनरी सर्च ट्री, वी नीड टू रिटर्न द सम ऑफ वैल्यूज ऑफ ऑल द नोड्स विद द वैल्यू बिटवीन लेफ्ट एंड एल एंड आर। द बाइनरी सर्च ट्री इज गारंटेड टू हैव द यूनिक वैल्यूज। सो these are the root nodes that are given, and nodes which are greater than 7 and less than 15, we have to give the sum between them. And that so greater than 7 is, you can here 10, and 7 is also included. 10, 7, 17, and 17 and 15, this 32. So the sum is 32 over here. And for this 6, and it's included. So 6 greater than 6 is and less than, it should be 10. 6, 7, you can take 13. 13 and this 10, 23. They'll sum, when you sum them up, it will be 23. And the number of nodes in the tree is at max, at most 10k. And the final answer is guaranteed to be less than this. Yeah. Yeah, so any queries in the question?
I think that is fine. Like, basically we need to take the sum between the range,
including left and right. But yeah.
So probably because this is binary search tree, if I do a in order, everything will be sorted.
Yeah, correct. Huh?
So basically, while doing in order, I can start the, I can look for where, what is the starting and what is the end, and take a sum in between.
Yeah, makes sense. From 7, in that sorted array from 7 to 15, you'll sum all the elements.
Yeah, by doing in order.
Yeah, by doing in order. Yeah. Any other apart from this? I think.
Is it query only once? Or it could be query multiple time.
It's once.
Once it's. You want to share the code? I mean, how did you do in order? Using normal recursion or simple this iterative?
I think recursion is fine. I think you can share your code if you have done with recursion.
This here I didn't use by in order. I've done that one. Let me check that. I think. Yeah, this one.
Oh, so you did using stack.
I used a stack because in interviews I find that they most of the time they ask you to implement in order using recursion.
Okay.
Yeah, because of that. So, yeah, I think this one I did. So just for in order traversal, we took first we'll insert the root. We'll go to the extreme left. So once you go to the extreme left, then you start popping from it, like let you and just check it's if there is a right child for this. Go then of that node, go to the right again, right of left you go. Yeah, so we'll go till this extent, and when you do all these things in this res, everything will be sorted. Just I got the index of left, index of right, and I'll sum them from left to right.
So technically what you could have done is, while doing this stack thing, you could have, while popping out, you could have, so right now what you're doing, you're putting all the things. Yeah. So basically what you're doing is you're putting in somewhere in the
array
result. You're putting everything in the result. Like if I have 10,000 nodes, I'll put all 10,000 in my result. And then if I'm only interested in very small range, I'm doing in order for everything. But what I'm saying is you don't need to put it in a result. As soon as you see the left node for the first time, have a something at the top. Just keep on, whatever you pop next time, just keep on adding. And when you see the right, just break it out.
Come out of the loop the moment you see it.
Yeah, just some sort of a flag you can keep as soon as you see the left. Yeah.
So when you see left for the first time, you can say status true, then keep on adding things. When you say right, then just break out and return. Then you don't need to put everything in the
array.
Yeah, and yeah, for example, if you have, let's say you have 10,000 numbers, and if I give you a range of 1 to 5, you might end up doing like in order for entire tree, but I might not be interested in that.
Makes sense.
We can even use priority queue, right? I mean, in that way, we can sort the elements, and let's suppose you want range from 7 to 5, 15, then we keep on popping out till we get 15, okay? Then after that, once we get 15, and we go on checking that until it's 7, since the priority queue will maxify itself. So in that way, it can be done only. We need only priority queue, then we don't need this array.
So putting in a priority queue would be like n log n. I have to again put all the elements in the priority queue, right?
Actually, that will be same like, I mean, whether you put in an array or priority queue, so you will require the same space. Requirement will be same, and again, the priority queue will be n log n.
And putting an array then is much faster. You put in an array, traverse the array in order of n, and find your range.
So BST itself give you the result sorted result, so actually you don't need the priority queue at all.
I think, sorry to interrupt, I did it via recursion, so is that fine?
Recursion, I think, because
that was like O of one memory as well, and on lead code it showed 0 milliseconds.
No, it's not O.
Recursion stack is there, like the call stack,
but I'm saying like I didn't store any values anywhere, I just kept adding to some.
That's perfectly fine.
One other thing you can do is, I think BFS, that just clicked my mind, right? You can, instead of doing all these things, you can do a BFS. And do a BFS only when the element is in range.
But you do the BFS, you can... you don't know like what the range is going to be.
No,
you have to travel to the next level, right?
No. It's sorted, right? Everything is sorted, correct?
So in this case, we do BFS. So let me see.
But sorted on level order sorted, right?
Yeah, BFS is that only.
No, I completely agree. But what I'm trying to say is, in case of BFS, right? You can put the elements only which you think can be of the answer. The same way you do in the case of recursion, right? So in case of recursion, you will basically either traverse the left or the right or both, depends on the value. For example, if the root value is within a range, right? It means that you have to consider the root as well as the left as well as the right tree, correct? And in case of if the root value is less than the range, it means that the element lies in the right side of the tree, and same way on the left side of the tree. Am I right?
Yeah, agree with that. But again,
in the same way, why can't you do a BFS? BFS, yeah.
But again, if you're doing BFS, you might end up doing traversing the entire tree. But if you're doing a DFS, using it in order, as soon as you are going out of range, you can break.
Yeah, so in case of BFS also, as soon as you're going out of range, you will not add that node.
No, but I don't need to visit all the nodes. But in BFS, I might end up visiting all the nodes.
Why you think like that?
Because if you see in order, if I do in order of this tree, how it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. As soon as I'm done with 5, I don't need to go 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Because I'm doing in order. Always 1 will come first, 2, 3, 4, 5. As soon as, and if my range is 2 to 5, I don't need to go further. But if I'm doing BFS, how should I know I need to stop?
You will know based on the value of the BFS key, no?
So okay, let me share my screen.
Sure. I think BFS will do the same job and the same way. I kind of agree with Goro.
Actually, okay. I think in BFS you'll always
traverse
the entire left train.
So but what I was
But when we will process for the BFS, so we will compare before putting into the queue. So we will compare that whether we should actually we need that node or not in future.
Yeah, it optimized that way too.
Okay. So what I was saying, this is an in-order traversal. Where
screen is not visible. I think.
Oh, screen is not visible.
It is visible.
Oh, it is visible.
Oh, sorry. I have.
You're looking somewhere else.
Yeah.
Okay. So what I was saying, this is a classic in-order traversal. Like what I was saying, let's say we don't have this thing. Mm. It's just in-order where I'm with. So where I'm just visiting this left, going left, then visiting node, and then going right.
Okay. Right?
So if I do in order of any BST, it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Correct. So what I'm saying, at this point, this is optimization. As soon as I'm going outside, I don't need to go further in order.
Okay, just a quick question before we go further. Why didn't you optimize for the left?
No, I need to first reach left. As soon as I pass right, I know I can't reach my answer. So basically, if my query is between 6, if I'm querying between 3 to 5,
mm-hmm.
Reach this point, I don't want to go 6 and 7, but at least I want to reach till 3.
Yeah, it's fine. But what I'm saying is, why didn't you optimize for the left part also?
I think it can be done.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think it can be done.
But yeah, he's just taking it the other way. It's fine.
Okay, yeah. Like, you can actually optimize both left and right, okay? So, let's say, what I'm trying to say is, if it's between 3 and 5, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, when you do a BFS, correct? Mm-hmm. And if you see a node which is left of 3,
mm-hmm.
okay, so you will not add into the next level. Okay?
Okay.
When you are adding, for example, when you're adding a left and a right child, correct? Into the queue, right? You will make the decision based on the values, whether it can be part of the solution or it cannot be part of the solution.
Mm-hmm.
And that way, I think the BFS will give you. I'm not seeing anything flawed in that approach. By the way, I also use the recursion approach which you used, but this is one of the approach I think we can take, because at the end of the day, BFS, DFS, in order to the order are actually the. Just the traversal of the.
Yeah, I think BFS should also work, but yes. Yeah.
So let's take some.
So this is more intuitive, you know this.
Yeah, it works. So Gaurav, so when we will process that particular level, and we know that particular node is smaller than the left value, but it might be possible that in future, the right some right value of that node may be greater than the left values.
For the root value, all the nodes which are on the left is smaller, and all the nodes which are right on the grid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you use that property, it can never happen that in future or whatever. What I'm taking is just make the decision at that point whether there can be any answers on the left and whether there can be answer on the right.
Okay.
I'm just quickly drawing a tree.
Sure.
In the meantime, can I just share my code?
Josh, I mean, already one is sharing.
Only one can share at a time.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying till he finishes drawing it.
Okay.
So it looks like this is a. So I think what the other person was telling, take a decision based on you can put that or not.
Yes.
So basically.
So let's say you are at 4, okay, currently.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say the range is
let's say 2 to 8.
Okay. Take an example 3 to 8.
Okay.
3 to 8. Okay.
Okay. And so the queue initially contains 4. Okay.
Yeah.
Because you realize that 4 is part of this range, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So now you will take out the 4 and print it. Okay.
So, okay. Because that is in the range.
Yes. Right. And then you will say, hey, my left is 2. Can it be part of the range? Oh, this is what you were saying. I see.
Yeah. That was my thinking that.
I see. Okay. Makes sense. Okay, sorry guys, I'm wasting your time.
But... No, that's fine.
It's the only thing is when you are putting the queue, you should not look for that value. But when you are adding it, you can actually add them. You know, but it's going to be traversing the whole tree.
Entire
tree.
Exactly. Yeah.
That doesn't make sense. That is true.
So it can still be done, but.
Yeah,
that's what I was saying. Like both in order, everything is same. Only thing is if we are doing this kind of thing, that's the optimization. Otherwise, they both are same. If I don't do this thing, then I'm as good as traversing the entire tree. Yeah.
By the way, you can also optimize on the left.
The BFS, we don't need to traverse the whole tree, right? We put the left node to the queue. The smaller we put the left node to the queue, when we pop it out, we don't process it, right? Because 2 is less than 3. And then we look at the right node on that 2 and the limit range and we add it.
Agree. But here we're discussing like a way to not process all the nodes of the tree.
Yeah, but this one we don't process the whole node because we don't, let's say we put 2 on the queue, right? We don't put 1 in the queue.
So as soon as I'm putting 2 in the queue, like I'm processing it kind of.
Right. Then when you pop it out?
I don't use it. That is a different story.
Yeah. Let's say you pop it out and you look at it not in the range, then that must be the value of 2. You only put in the queue the right child of 2, right? Which is 3. You don't need to put the left child of 2. Because left child 2 is smaller. So in this case, we only traverse parts of the tree only.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's also saying the same thing. Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Can I ask?
Yeah. Hello? Yeah, somebody wants to share the code. Yeah, please go ahead. I have stopped sharing.
Would this be in order? Hello?
Yeah, it's visible.
Would this be in order traversal?
Yeah, this is like a pre-order. Yeah.
Pre-order.
Oh.
Yes, any traversal could work here.
Yep.
Because we are just checking the range. So if you are visiting all the nodes, any traversal could work. It could be BFS, BFS with in order, pre-order, or post-order.
But I thought that by my if conditioning, I wouldn't visit every node. Do you think every node is still getting visited?
Yes, I think so.
Because I'm checking if the value is greater than L or less than R.
Okay.
So like if in your previous graph, when you had 2, I wouldn't really go to 1 because I would see it's above L. But I would go to 3 because it's, less than that.
Okay, I see. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, I just wanted to ask. Thank you.
Yeah, this should work. Yeah.
Yeah, I can go further. So we can switch to next.
Yes.
No.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's the stuff.
Yeah. So this is like most profit assigning work. We are given. We have jobs. There is an array of difficulty which is the difficulty of the ith job, and profit of I is the profit of the ith job. Now we need to take some of the workers from the array worker I. And it denotes the ability of the ith worker, which means that this worker can only complete a job with utmost difficulty worker of I. Every worker can be assigned at most one job, but this one job can be done multiple times. Let's say if 3 people attempt the same job
that pays $1, then the total profit will be $3. And if a worker cannot complete any job, his profit is $0. So what is the most profit we can make? So this is the difficulty area that they have given. Corresponding to them, the profit is given. And this is the ability of each of the worker, like ability of the IEth worker, which means that this worker can complete a job with utmost difficulty worker of I. So here, how did they get this is, let's say if we would have started with the, I mean, our aim is to get the most profit. If we would have started with 50, corresponding to that is difficulty is 10. But you don't have any worker who can do this level of job, I mean, this difficulty level of job. So we are skipping 50. Next, if we switch to 40, corresponding to 40, again, we have difficulties 8, but we don't have any worker who can complete this type of work. So we are ignoring that. Now we'll go for the 30. Corresponding to 30, we have 6, and that kind of worker we are having. And he can do multiple jobs. I mean, it's written, can multiple jobs can be completed. So if he does it 2 times, you'll get 60 out of that. And on switching to 20, corresponding to this, you have 4 difficulty, and corresponding to that, you have worker. So 2 times is doing this. So 60 plus 40, this is the 100. This is how they got. And these are the notes constraints, like difficulty's length and profit length will be less than 10K. And worker's length, again, less than 10K. And these are in the range of 1 to 10 raised to the power 5. Yeah, any queries on the question?
So actually looking at this, it came across like a greedy sort of approach because of knapsack. I thought it drew parallels with knapsack, but I don't think that's the actual solution, is it?
Greedy we are using in this. We can use greedy.
Is that sorted? It looked like it's sorted.
Example it looks like, but it's not given anywhere.
Yeah, it's not sorted. It's given. Matlab, this example looks like that.
Yeah, but if, yeah. So, okay, I see. If it's not sorted, then when Sean go from right to left, for the example, it may not work, right?
Yeah, if it's not sorted. Hmm. Any approach in this? Like, how do you?
It looks greedy to me, but I can never formulate a greedy solution as such.
I can think of this as sorting, let's say difficulty and profit, right?
Mm-hmm.
I can think of this as sorting by difficulty. And if the two difficulties are same, then sorted, which is having the maximum profit. Okay.
If a tie situation is there.
In the case of a tie situation, I think. I'm not sure whether that would be helpful. I have to still think, but if there's a tie situation, I will think of profit as coming before as difficulty. Okay. Means more profit will come before less profit. Okay.
Once if you have a tie, it means you just have to take the biggest profit, right?
Exactly. That's what I was saying. So, and once we have that, right, then on the worker array, right, there multiple things can be done. For example, on the worker array, you can run a binary search. For example, for 4, right? You will with the help of 4, you will try to figure out the index for which the difficulty is less than or equal to 4. Okay. And the maximum one will be the answer for the 4. Same way with 5 and 6 and 7.
Somewhat similar to greedy, doesn't it? Seems like less than four.
It's a greedy.
Yeah.
So you always pick the one which is having the maximum difficulty and sufficient for your constraint.
Yeah.
Hmm. Could you give an example about a Thai case?
Sure.
You want to share the screen?
1 minute. I didn't understand why are we picking most difficult element and not highest profit?
Pardon?
I mean, the person who was speaking earlier said that we look for the
element which has the highest difficulty.
Can you see my whiteboard?
Yeah, it's visible. Yeah.
Okay, let's discuss. Why are we going with the max profit?
Okay, let me first take example. Okay.
Okay.
So, what was this one? Can you see now my lead code screen? No.
No.
Okay,
can you see the whiteboard?
Okay.
Whiteboard, yes.
Okay, never mind. So this is it, right? So this is a difficulty given, and this is a profit given, right? And this is basically the workers, right? And luckily for this input, everything is currently sorted, right?
Yeah.
So, but this is not given in the question. So it means that you have to sort it. Okay.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay. So now the first question is, first let me tell you my approach of greedy, and then I will tell you why it works. Okay. So what I will do is, let's say 4, right? Get the 4. Okay. So currently I'm trying to solve my equation for 4 index, for 4th value. Okay. And I will basically try to search in the difficulty array that I will start from the 6. Like I'm doing a binary search, right? So I will start from the 6, the middle element, and try to see whether 4 is less than or greater than. 4 is less than basically 6. So my answer cannot be on the right side. So I just move to the left. Okay. So now I see a 4, right? And here I see that whether the 4 is greater than, less than, or equal to, it is equal to. Okay. So this can be an answer. This can be an answer. I'm not saying this is my answer. This can be an answer because let's say there is one more 4 and let's say the value is 30. Okay. This is possible, right? So I'm just saying this can be my answer, the third index, but not sure whether it's an answer or not. So I will just make a record during binary search that 30 can be my answer. Okay. And then decrement my end by 1-1. Okay. Continue my binary search. And in the end, I will just reach here and will compare the value. There is already one more index which satisfies this constraint, 30. Sorry, earlier it was 20, but now it is satisfied. So it becomes 30, right? In the binary search. Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay, so now I will take a value of 30 as my answer for 4th, right? Same way I carry out the search for 5, but I will just reach the 6, assume start the 6 again. And so 5 is less than 6, so I reach at this 4, correct? The second index. So 5 is greater than 4, so this can be a possible answer. 30 can be a possible answer.
Yeah.
And 30 can be a possible answer, and then I search for 4. But in this case, it's coming out 20. So I think we should reverse this thing now. Like
from back
from 20.
Actually, when you'll have to do a sorting for the difficulty. So you'll have to do similar adjustments for the profit also.
Yeah.
So you know, either you remove that 4 wherever there is redundancy, and you just add the profit which is maximum, because we are actually looking for maximum profit only. Right.
Yeah, that is.
So it doesn't make sense to have the lower profit value.
Yeah, I think so. This will not work again. Sorry, guys.
No, but when you just like, I mean, other thing is like, when you also, I mean, when you sort the profit by profit and difficulty together, like, and also on the worker side, when you sort the worker, you can just do a O of N. Like, you can just keep traversing.
That is also possible. But I think this approach is flawed. That's what I'm saying.
So binary search can work. What you are doing actually also can work, but you still will have to do a sorting, you know, for the difficulty, profit, and all the way, also on the workers. When you do a sorting, binary search will work.
Yes,
that's what he assumed already. The input is already sorted.
That's what I said. Like in this case, it is sorted, but still it doesn't work. That's what I'm saying.
So you have to sort it like.
But you'll have to change that, you know, the profit and difficulties.
Yeah.
You'll have to make a tie case. Yeah. But Santos mentioned that you can remove the small profit before, right?
So or I think one other thing you can do is you can have some kind of an auxiliary array or temp array, right? And once this is sorted, right, you can always say for difficulty 2, what is the maximum profit I can get? 10. For difficulty 4, what's the maximum profit I can get? 30. For difficulty 4, what is the maximum profit I can get? 30. For difficulty 6, what is the maximum profit I can get? 30. For 8, it's 40. For 10, it's 50. Does it make sense? And then you will search on this area.
Yeah, you usually do a map, actually. You'll have to map it because you'll have to always look at the difficulties also. When you are
I mean to say, like, you will maintain this as well as the difficulty.
Yeah.
Not independent, because you need to take it. But okay. What I'm saying is, direct profit, you cannot make anything out of.
Yes. Yeah.
Because that way there is a possibility that a higher difficulty have less profit. So you cannot.
Yeah, this makes sense.
So basically from this, construct this guy, and it says, let's say map, right? So that's what tuple, right? Kind of a tuple. So something like this. And after that, you can either use binary search and then optimize a binary search, or you can just sort the worker array, because anyway, both the cases, it will be n log n, right? Yeah. Because if you binary search, it's log n, and you are doing on n element, so it's n log n. Same way with worker, but you can optimize this for the binary search, because once you have figured out an index and it is sorted, then you can just, yeah, like you can do it anyway you want.
Guys, I have one solution. Shall I share?
Go ahead.
Yeah. So I think one thing that we can do is this difficult array we have given, right?
Arpit, can you share your screen, please?
Yeah, sure. Share screen, yeah. Whiteboard.
Zoom, you will have share screen option.
I think that's what I'm looking for. Share screen, then desktop. Yeah.
It's the center icon on the bottom panel.
Yeah. I found it. Share. I think.
Once we click on the share, you can go to the browser, whichever you want to share.
Actually, I'm running it into Zoom's app.
Oh, from phone?
No, from laptop only.
You should be, yeah, you can.
Okay, just describe your problem, no issues. Yeah, go ahead.
Even with the app, you can share, actually. You can a share button on the, like, you can minimize the window and then you can see the share.
Now seeing it.
Yeah. So what I was thinking is, as we have a little bit small constraint on the maximum value we can have for difficulty, right? So what we can do is for ith difficulty, for a particular value of difficulty, we can create one array, and at each index, we will basically store the maximum profit for the difficulty. So for example, in the given problem, for difficulty of 2, we can get maximum profit of 10, right? So,
yeah.
Hello. So at 2, at second index, we will write 10, right? Now, if we have, say for difficulty of 4, we can have maximum profit of 20, right? So it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, here we will write 20. Now, what we can do, we can calculate maximum prefix of this array. So for example, for difficulty 0, I have say no profit. For difficulty 1, I have no profit. Say for this difficulty, I have no profit. And for say let's assume we have a profit of say 30 for this difficulty. Now I have no profit for this difficulty. So what I will do, I will calculate maximum prefix. So here I will get 10, here I will get 30, here I will get 30. Here also I will get 30. Guys, I'm really sorry. I'm writing first time like this. So if it's bad, please forgive me for this one.
That's okay.
Awesome. So we will write like this, 30, 30, 30. So now for any difficulty, what is the maximum profit you can get? You can compute that in O of one time, right?
Yeah.
So now what you will do, we will traverse our array. And for each worker, we have its difficulty threshold, right? So we will, for that particular value, we will find what is the maximum profit we can make, and we will simply add it to our answer. So this way, I think it will be solved in constant space and linear time.
So the space is 10 to the power 5, right?
Yeah, right. 10 to the
power 5. Yeah, that will be.
So even though my input is just the 10 entry, so I'll have to allocate 10 to the power 5.
Yeah, right.
But when you do the sorting, you can do the same thing, right? You do sorting, you walk through the and you know, implement this approach to say what the maximum profit so far we update the value.
Yeah, but the space complexity is slightly higher on this, but the time complexity is very good, I would say.
And how will you handle the duplicate here?
He's actually storing the value, maximum profit.
Yeah, we are storing the maximum value profit, so duplicates won't bother us.
Okay.
Yeah, but time complexity is very good in this because it's almost O of N. But you still will have to sort the worker array.
No, I think we will not have to solve it.
Even if you don't do it, it should be fine. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So usually that's...
So do you have the code for this?
Yeah, please could you share the code later?
Sure. Of course, I will share it.
Thank you.
Now you can share.
If you have, I can share it.
I can share it right now, I think.
Sure.
Just a minute, I'm opening my ID.
So what if we take the maximum, since you are saying that we have to allocate 10 raised to 5, like we have to give so much of space, but if we can find out what is the maximum element, here it was just 5, so we can just allocate an array of 5, right?
Yeah.
But that way you will not be able to find in constant time, right? Like what is the maximum profit you can get for a particular difficulty?
So she mean make an array of 5 element only.
Yeah. I'm talking about the allocation of space.
Okay. So, fine. So, yeah, you will only have that much if your maximum value is actually 10 raised to 5, right?
Yeah, right. So, if I find the maximum element in the array, I mean, that will, of course, increase the time complexity, might be, to find a maximum.
Yeah, but that would be linear. So, just a minute. So, I need to share the browser right now, right?
Mm-hmm. But in that case, still, you'll have to look for the maximum difficulty value. And then you will have to create a area in that. So it will be traversing off and there.
Which should be okay, right? Because, you know, the max.
Yeah, to some extent optimized. Yeah. And that's right.
Just a minute. I'm sharing my screen. I'm currently sharing the whiteboard. Now I want to change it. So finding that option.
So you first stop the sharing, then you can do it.
Yes. Yeah. So... Now I'm going to share the browser. Yeah, so here's my code. So actually I have find out the maximum difficulty only first and created array of that size. Are you all able to see my code?
Yeah. So could you quickly walk through this?
Yeah, sure. So first I have found out the maximum difficulty. Then I have created array of size maximum difficulty plus 1. Then what I have done for like I have this difficulty and profit. Just a minute. Difficulty and profit. Just a minute.
So it might be some map maybe.
Yeah, right. So in difficulty map and profit of I have written set value of difficulty I to max of difficulty I and profit I. Because I want to take max till current profit.
Mm-hmm.
Now what I'm doing is I'm calculating just its prefix sum, maximum prefix sum. In difficulty and profit array in this step. Now, basically, I think this one is for handling the duplicate case. If, for example, you have some difficulty with less profit and same difficulty with higher profit, so higher profit one should get selected. So basically, line number 14 is handling that part.
Yep, I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now I am calculating maximum prefix sum of this array, difficulty and profit array. Now I have, once we have that, I am just traversing over our workers. And now for each worker, I can find the capability and maximum difficulty. Yeah.
Yeah, because you're taking the value, right, from the difficulty and profit.
Yeah, yeah. Right, right. So this way it's working.
How long will it take on lead code?
6 milliseconds.
I just had a query. In case the max difficulty is like a really high value, won't we get memory limit exceeded?
So for example, in this problem, the constraint is given that its maximum value only be up to 10 raised to 5.
Oh, okay. But that still won't be a memory issue. Mm-hmm.
Okay. No, till you can create array till 10 raised to 6 or 10 raised to 7. That's fine.
Acha, okay. So this will work in interviews as well, right? I mean,
It depends on your interviewer. Interviewer might pick the question that he might not allow you to this much of extra space.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can you explain again what is the mean capacity and max difficulty on line 21?
Yeah, I'm also confused there.
Okay, so just a minute. So say capability is 5.
So it is possible that your max difficulty is too much. Max difficulty is less, but your capability is too high.
Right. To handle that.
So your array would be a small of smaller size.
So for example, if say max value is only 1, max difficulty's value is only 1. Now say if your worker has a capability of say 10, right? Then you will start getting index out of bounds error. So to handle you have taken minimum.
Nice solution.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You can stop sharing, I think.
Yeah. Can you share your option?
Yeah, sure.
The sorting one, or whoever is actually going to share.
Once you stop.
Just a minute. I'm doing it.
Okay.
I'll
stop. So what I did, I went throughout the array of difficulty and I sorted them based on the first, I took couple of these values, first value from difficulty, from profit, and sorted it on the base of difficulty. First value, X of 0. And then and I sorted this worker array also, and corresponding for every worker, I'll check if it is less than the array length. And this, we are checking here the difficulty is less than the capacity of the worker. And with difficulty less than the capacity of the worker and picking the max out of it and just increasing the I value by 1 and just adding it to the maximum value to this answer.
Where did you handle the duplicate, Shashank?
Duplicate, I think this will take care of, right? Each difficulty will check whether it is less than the capacity of a worker. And in that case, it won't bother you. Duplicate values. Because if 4 has capacity of something, if 4 comes, that will also be handled here only.
Yeah, your line number 10 will take it, I think. You're taking a local maximum. That's a local max and a global answer, right? That's a local maximum you are maintaining in the most, right?
This one?
Yeah. So if there are duplicates, the line number 10 will take care, right?
Yeah.
I
think so. You still will have to actually do something in the in your map, right? Because
I think
you are taking line number 4 when you were storing that. You are actually looking for... Oh, no. Okay.
What is the time complexity?
This should be n log n, right?
Time complexity, you are saying.
Sorry. I think it should be n square.
Yeah. N log n.
No. Not n log n. Because he's actually iterating the list, right? In the line number 9.
Right. At least n square, I would say.
It will not be n square, worst case, I think.
Yeah.
It's not n square. Basically, the worker is already sorted. So you will not... When you started, you start with the lower worker and your I is already set to the respective one, right?
Okay, right. We are not re-declaring I.
Because you're not decrementing I, you're just keep incrementing I here.
Keep on increasing.
Yeah, right.
So it will be, But then why execution time is so high?
Pardon?
Because number of jobs are too much.
Because we are not resetting I anywhere again. I is set before the for loop.
No, I'm saying why execution time is so high.
Sample size is huge, right?
So for example, my O of N solution was taking around 16 milliseconds. So,
because of language. Your code was in Java, this was in Python. Java runs faster.
It depends, as you have used the extra space, so might be your space may be higher than busy space.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can check both. So you actually trade with the space, right?
Yeah, right. Okay.
Sorry if I missed anything. What was the time complexity for this problem, for the solution?
N log n.
What did we agree upon? N log n.
Yeah.
It's n log n plus something more, right?
I'm talking about the while loop on 9th line. How would that contribute to the time complexity? So basically, should be n squared.
No. So on line number I, we are checking I is less than L, and we are not resetting I. So basically, I will run maximum up to n times.
So
your while, this internal while loop, during entire course of execution, it will run just n times.
Yes, and the outside.
Yeah, but the outer loop. Outer loop is also.
Yeah, so it's basically something like n plus n.
Yeah.
So it will become n square when you are doing n units of work for each value of I.
Oh, okay.
So for example, if you run this worker loop and if inside you are traversing entire array every single time, then it will become n square. Mm-hmm. You are aggregatingly executing internal array only n times.
Okay. So what is right? So
yeah,
it should be
still called n square.
No.
Shashank, is it possible for you to like explain your like each step like written the way we done yesterday? If it's possible.
Sure.
Comment. We are doing two sorts, right? One is for the difficulty and one is for the worker. So the time complexity will be like n log n for the difficulty, and then there will be some other
k log k
behind, something like that for the worker.
Yeah.
So therefore, actually, they also mention it like that.
Dominating factor will be that only, n log n.
And dominating factor depends on whoever is the bigger.
But both of them are there, right? It's not dominating. It is sequential there.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Should I walk through examples?
Like, yeah, please.
Okay, yes, sure. Please.
Sure. From where? I mean, right from beginning, right?
Yeah, if it's possible.
Yeah, sure. So we have this. What do you say? We'll take in difficulty array. We are sorting based on the first value. Okay, wait. I think I have to pick it up. Yes. I think here it won't make any difference because the array is already sorted in that, what do you say,
So yeah, based on the first value of the difficulty will sort. So 210, then your here it will be same. 630 and 840 and 1050. Yeah, this you got this array. Now your worker array is this, I think.
Can I add something here? Can we do duplicate for 2 also? So 2 can have 10 also, and then 2 can have 20 also. So just after 210, add 220. Yeah,
and here corresponding to that 10 only, right?
No, I want it. I mean, we say that there can be duplicates and something can have maximum profit, right? For the same difficulty. So
You can put that as 5. Say for
you can take 215.
Two or five.
Correct, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can have 15 here. Now we can walk through the array. Corresponding to this 4, you can check difficulty of ith and 0, this one, 2. This is your less than the worker capacity, right? So you'll pick max of most, I think I've defined as 0. Max of 0 and difficulty of i1, so 10. So max of these two will be 10. Next, again, I will, length of difficulty is here, right? Now I'll, for the next worker, I go for the next difficulty. Difficulty is 4 here. So your, and difficulty of i0, again, this, if you check 2, this is less than your difficulty of the worker. Now the max it will take of 10 and 15. 10 and 15, it will be 15. So now next you check for 6. 6 is... you compare with the difficulty.
Next will be 4 and 20.
Next will be 4 and 20. We are iterating through this. What do you say? Difficulty array. So next will be 6.
We are still in the inner while loop yet.
So for each worker, each difficulty.
So the next element is 420, not 630.
Yeah,
it's still a valid element.
The array is, we have modified this array. This is not that. I was looking there. This is the difficulty array because
But it's a while loop, right? So it will still go to 630.
It will be between 15 and 20 max.
15 and 20 max will be written.
Yeah, I think I got the idea now. Yeah,
and subsequently, you can again check for 8 and 30. Corresponding to 8, you'll have 30. So max of these two, it will take. Now 30 it will have.
No, 6 is 30.
No, so for this worker, your maximum profit that you can earn is 20. So now you'll move to the next worker because the next difficulty is 6. So this worker cannot do that job.
So answer is right now 20. And then now you move to 5.
Worker array is 4, 5, 6, 7. So 4, the worker with the capability of 4 has done his job and he has taken the maximum profit 20. So now you'll move to the worker with the capability 5 and you'll look further because he has the more capacity, so he need not look back.
Okay, so this is why LeetCode brands this problem as a two-pointer problem. Basically, the pointer stays there. We don't start from the beginning each time. So then how did you get K log K?
The worker is sorted, right?
So it's N log N plus Q log Q, no?
How do you get the Q log Q? I'm sorry, I don't know how to get
that. The size of the worker.
The worker
size
is ordered.
Of the difficulty is different than the size of the worker.
But there's one problem. Suppose if the first element, if you had it 200 rather than 210.
Yeah.
No. I'm talking about the pair. The pair 2 and 10, it has 2, 100. Is it like a valid thing because you've sorted using worker? So now for the worker with the capability 5, you won't consider this element.
It's sorted based on difficulty, na?
Based on difficulty, first value, difficulty. This is the first value, no?
Profit thousand, hundred.
Yeah, so let's make profit, okay, right? So max profit is 100, right? For the job.
I'm most concerned about...
The max profit will change always.
So I would say that, I mean, while sorting your difficulty, so here you have to actually to handle the duplicate. So if the difficulty, the profit is same, then sort in...
Okay. So let's just... I'll make this different then. Instead of making the 10 one as 100, make 420 as 100. The element with the capability. Difficulty 4. The third element in the pair array.
Mm.
Make that as 200.
Yeah.
Or whatever. Make that as the maximum element. So, since you have, when you came to this number, you have incremented the I, you won't consider this element again for the next worker when you're picking. But that worker with the capacity, a capability of 5 can do this job. And a job can be taken multiple times.
Yeah.
So, isn't it the wrong solution?
No, but most is already set to 200. So, we do max of most in the next difficulty. So, it will be max of 230.
Okay. So, you're not resetting the most.
No, he's not resetting. So, he's always taking the maximum value.
2.0. Okay.
It's slightly tricky to understand that, but yeah, that works.
So, Q log Q, are we considering like the worker array to be size Q?
Yeah, I think.
But how do we say that the inner while loop is log Q? I mean, if the interviewer asks you what's your reasoning behind it, how should I answer that?
Okay, so basically thing is that we are sorting two array overall, right? Say one is of size N and one is of size Q.
Yeah, that is N log N in the beginning.
Yeah,
so in beginning
only, there is one complexity for n log n and another one is for q log q, right? So your complexity is becoming n log n plus q log q. Now, you start with the loop. So your overall loop, outer loop will run n times. Fine?
Yeah.
Now, k times basically. K times. And inner loop will overall run n times.
Q times.
Number of jobs time.
Yeah, so it will be always n plus q.
Yeah, n plus q. Now, since our n log n and q plus q is bigger than n, so our linear part got ignored and we have chosen the maximum out of those.
Yeah. So since I
understood that it's n log n plus q log q. I'm just asking that in this q log q or k log q, that while loop, how do we say that it's logarithm time, that while loop?
No, the while loop is not logarithm time. That is Q time.
So the outer, this is log. So the while loop is my confusion.
I mean, while you sort your difficult array, so actually you have to handle at time sorting when you have the duplicate. So for duplicate value, you have to sort the internal value in a descending order. So in that case, you don't need the while loop here. You just go and hit the first value, and that will be your maximum profit in that case.
Yeah, if we were to remove duplicates, yeah.
So that's all depend on your how do you write your comparator for your sorting? How do you compare your element and sort them?
Okay.
So even for this inner while loop, if you see the condition, I is less than L, so it can only run maximum L times.
Okay.
So the outer loop is independent of that. That will run N times. So N plus L.
Okay.
For this nested loop, which was creating confusion.
Yeah, because if someone were to ask me, like if an interviewer were to ask me, I would say that it's n log n plus n into q. I wouldn't say, you know, q log q. That's right.
Yeah, but since we are not resetting ISO.
So it's more prudent that when it's not completely n, take a lower version, log n.
No, the log n is not taken for this. So this, this
sorry, log k, are, log q.
Yeah, even I don't, the, it's not log k. The, for these two loops, the time complexity would be n plus q.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay, let's proceed to next or any further queries in this.
I think we can move to next one. If
okay.
Everyone is okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So this one, we need to find the largest value in each of the row, three row. So in the first row, you'll have one, here three, and here nine.
Okay.
So any approach in this?
I think we can
level order.
Yeah, level order table is simple.
Taking max at each level, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, normal BFS.
Yeah, right. Actually, I came across a very good problem a couple of days back. So do you mind if I share that instead of this? Because if everyone is aware of level order, so it will not make sense to solve this.
No, I want to go through it. I'm so sorry, please.
Okay, fine. Perfect.
Can post the link till then?
Yeah, sure. I'll find.
On the chat. If
yeah, sure. Go it.
Yeah, it's the same like double-ended queue you used. I pass the tuple of values root along with the label, created a dictionary which will contain corresponding to label water values. Like for level 0, you'll have one, level 2, this will have this and this.
Yeah.
So I'm popping it from the left side, then appending nodes at the correct level, and going for the left and increasing the level by one. And again, going to the right and increasing the level by one. And at last, I'll take the max from each of the level. I mean, I'll go to the particular level, check all the values, which is maximum. Put inside the list again for this maximum.
Okay. Yeah.
This is the dictionary. Corresponding to 0, you'll have 1, 3, 2, 2, 5, and to them.
I have one question. So I code in Java and if there's any Java developer here, what's the best substitute for a tuple in Java? Because that's like the only thing I can't, you know, find a replacement for in Java.
I think from Java 9, there's a pair
class. You can use pair class. Or if you don't have, you can make your own pair class.
Okay, yeah, you can. Have to make the best thing is to make your own, because I don't think it might not be available on the JDK that you're...
Yeah, especially like the online judge may not allow that. Yeah.
So,
okay.
One thing I would like to suggest. So I think the better way to do code this would be so without using a tuple actually. So
yeah, actually you can keep an inner while loop and to the size of the queue.
Yeah. So actually you can traverse. So basically what you will do you will inside this while queue loop, you will put one more for loop or say while loop. You will find out, take out the size of queue at start. So now you know that you are there are exactly that much elements of a particular level, right?
Yeah.
So for example, if initially I put one into the queue and if I pop so before popping one, I know there is exactly one element in the queue and that belongs to a single level, right? Now say, after traversing this, if I put two more elements into the queue, three and two. Now, when I come into the outer while loop again, I know that there are two elements in the queue. Now, since I have not added element of any other level, I know both of these elements will belong to a single level, right?
Yeah.
So what I will do, I will traverse inner for loop exactly two times. Basically, current size of the queue times.
Okay, so you're suggesting not adding the children nodes until you finish processing parent nodes.
No, you will keep adding them, but since you have already, you are using queue, right? So there will be no elements added in between. And you are traversing it exactly that much number of times. And your elements will get added back of the queue.
At each level, get the count how many number of nodes actually you added to the at that level.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Oh, okay, so that is track length, of how many elements.
Yeah, I'm sharing the code.
Length of you should be less than length of level, right? I mean, less than equal to length of level.
Okay. In this code right here, is that BFS or def? Is that DFS? Because no, it keep adding.
The BFS.
Yeah. So I have found the code from that approach as well. Anyone want to see that?
Yeah, sure. Share it.
Yeah.
Even I have posted something on the, but you can show it on
thank
screen.
You.
Okay, fine.
That's a trivial, BFS.
Yeah, yeah, right. Trivial BFS.
Hmm. If somebody can share it.
Yeah, sure. I'll share it. Yeah. So are you able to see my screen?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have this function level order traversal. So here we have created one queue of type tree node.
Mm-hmm.
And list to store result. It's not code for this problem. It's code for general BFS.
Yeah, it's for the previous problem. Yeah.
No, not previous problem. General BFS.
Not previous. I mean, it was the level of the question. The lead code. This is the first one.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Fine. Actually, I didn't see that. So then what we are doing? We are first adding root to the queue. Then we are running outer while loop while queue is not empty, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we have figured out size of the queue. And now inner for loop, we are running exactly size times. Because
your code is doing that only, right? You're first finishing processing parent nodes and only then adding this thing, child nodes, right?
In
the
current. Adding them simultaneously only, in this for loop only.
So you're not maintaining the level here, just not using the XP. That is a trick over here.
Yeah, but on this code or the previous one, we only need to keep track of the max value, right? So we don't need to put everything to the array.
In this for loop, we can keep a track.
Yeah, you will basically initialize one max array, max element equal to say zero, and you will take max of integer dot max, max comma.
Node value.
Node dot value. Something like this. And at the end, you will put max in the answer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We can use a null object to differentiate between the levels, then no need of.
So basically earlier I used to code that way, but that way it becomes, code becomes your little uncleaner.
Better way, right? You put a level root and a null object. Null object, then when you pop the null object and then you get a null object pop from queue, then you can push another null object. So that means we completed a second level. When you get a null object of the second after second level, that means you all pushed all the third level into the queue.
Yeah, yeah. So
separator queue.
Yeah, yeah. So basically, I used to code it that way earlier. But actually, I like this approach. I prefer this one over that because in that, it's easy to mess up with null pointer and all those things.
Yeah, and this one work only with Java, that null pointer approach with C++. If you have to put in your queue just the integer, so that approach will not work. So this is a generic approach will work with whether you put a pointer or just a normal inbuilt variable.
Right, it's a good point actually.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, you can do it the other way also, what he was talking about. Dilip was talking about the null pointer. So that is also one approach, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, right. Of course, that's one correct one.
Yep.
Yeah.
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Arpit. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, Arpit, you're going to share.